for every example molecule we'll look at. So then we'll just start doing what's very often done in literature, and ChemDraw does the same way. We'll draw a line and we'll leave off a chunk so that you won't see the mechanism for that part. We'll see just the loss of the chunk. So we'll see mechanism once, and then we'll practice what these are going to be. So don't forget your exam is Monday in lab. And that means we'll be having a normal lecture. So we're going to be starting carboxylic acids. And there are some PowerPoints on E2L that I would like you guys to make sure you get all of the Tier 4 stuff and come in to lecture and read those on Monday. And don't forget, too, that you have the T13 and Mass Spec quizzes that need to be completed by Sunday night. Okay? All right, let's go ahead and get started then. We are going to go into alkenes. Now we can start, as we go through the rest of these functional groups, pinpointing where the electron comes from. With the alkanes and cyclic alkenes, all those things, we kind of just said an electron is leaving from a sigma bond somewhere, which wasn't all that useful. But now we actually do know where things are leaving. So as our example mechanism, that guy right there will be 1-butene. I have different kinds of bonds now. I have sigma bonds and I have pi bonds. And if you guys remember, it went sigma, pi, n on an energy diagram. So the pi bonds, or the pi electrons, are the more loosely held electrons. And we've seen that with reactions. The pi electrons in reactions, they're the ones that go out and attack things. Sigma bond electrons do not attack things. And so what we're going to be doing is we are going to remove a pi electron. So now we can very specifically draw where this electron is going to be coming from. So this thing gets hit by the high energy beam of electrons, and we are knocking an electron out of the pi bond. So redrawing this, I am going to draw it as plus and dot. So I'm removing one electron from this. So that means I have to assign a radical to a carbon, and the other carbon gets the plus. So one carbon is a radical, one is a plus. Now I chose to draw it this way, because in the mechanism, that's what's going to work for me. That was arbitrary. And so as we go through lecture, sometimes I may choose to draw it another way. Let's say I went dot plus. I chose to do it that way. What's going to happen if you have chosen the way that's not going to work for the mechanism? When you go to the next step, you're going to be like, oh, I should have written it the other way. It doesn't matter. Both ways are right. But just one way is much more conducive to actually tell what's happening during the image. Okay? And I know for a fact that the top one is the picture I want, so we'll be working off that. Okay? But it's not, if you draw like this, and then the next step you're like, oh, darn, redraw it the other way. Okay? So, the most common kind of cleavage is where we are going to be trying to form an allylic carbocation. Stabilized by resonance. That would be a fairly stable fragment. So what we are going to do is I am going to go, not involving the carbons that are part of the double bond, I'm going to go to the neighboring carbon, and I am going to do an allylic cleavage. So I am going to break right there. So you go to the allylic carbon, you break the allylic position. And I'm going to have one electron go with the CH3, and I'm going to have one electron stay with what was my alkene originally. And when I redraw this, so I'm losing a CH3 radical. Redrawing this, it's going like this, plus, dot, dot. That's kind of weird. Drawing it like that. If I have two electrons on neighboring carbons, what can they form?
A bond.
Form a bond, right? So I'm going to redraw this. And it will look like that. So it's an allylic carbon cation. Okay. Now the mass of this thing overall, I guess it would be helpful to know that, is 56. So this molecular ion is 56. We're going to see the spectrum in just a minute, so just keep that in mind. I just lost 15. So this is 56 minus that methyl, which is 15. That's going to come out to be 41. So we should see if we can 41. And if you take a look, let's just jump forward to the spectrum, you see something at 56. It's fairly big. And then a really big peak at 41. And it's really big because there's a lot of that ion, because it's an allylic carbon cation. It's really stable. Okay, there is something at 27, and that is going to come from a cleavage that's not as common, and that's why it's smaller. But that is a vinylic cleavage, and that was the second thing on the previous slide. So less frequently, you can actually see vinylic cleavage. And let's go ahead and draw that mechanism out. We'll just zoom over here and do it. You don't get such a stable piece when you do this. So we're going to start with the same molecular ion plus that. And with vinylic cleavage, I am going to break right at the vinyl position, not the allylic position, but the vinyl position. And I go one electron. So I am losing an ethyl radical. And I'm being left with this. Let's just draw it out for real. CH2 plus, and then CH with two electrons on it. Okay, I'm going to redraw this. Redrawing it, I'm going to bring those two electrons down and have them form a bond. And what this actually looks like is this. CH2, CH, and O plus right there. That thing has a mass of 12, so 24 and 3 has a mass of 27. That is that small thing that you see there, 27. It's kind of tough to deal with that one because there's a 27, there's a 28, there's a 29. That's all the same mass as that ethyl group that can be lost too, right? So it's not. This is not nearly as good an indicator as the allylic cleavage. That's really what you're looking for. Is allylic cleavage. That's the most important one. Okay, so by way of practice, let's do something a little more complicated and see if we can identify some peaks. All right, got a lot more branching in this next one. And that's 69. see something at 69 in there? It is, it's this really big peak right there. So it ended up being your base peak, is the one at 69. That wasn't the only thing I could have done, though. I could have, let's kind of redraw it. There's my parent again. I could have taken off the metal. And if I did that, it would look like that. And that would be 98 minus the metal, which is 1583. Not as good, but still there. So 83 is this kind of smaller one right there. Okay? Look how big the parent is. Alkenes overall tend to give pretty large parent peaks. They're pretty obvious, so that's kind of nice. So there's our 98. There's losing the methyl. There is losing the ethyl. Okay? We're going to have to deal with that thing at 41 because it's big. And so to take a look at what it is, if you go and work it out, it is actually from my biliary leakage. And I'll just give you the piece. So we go to our parent. And we have plus dot. And the piece that is breaking off is that entire butyl piece, that big butyl piece at the end. So we will break off here and here. And we will have then this, this, plus, one dot. And then we've lost this chunk. And we can redraw. Add this all up, that's the thing at 41. There's something at about 55, 56, 57 that we haven't addressed. What would you guess that is?
The other piece.
Yeah, the stuff at 55. There's kind of, let's put 55 to 57 and sort of the range there and try to figure out what it is. 57 is a butyl type thing. So 57 has got to be that butyl piece coming off. Where is it attached right there? Coming off as the carbocation. What do you think the 55 is?
Loss of two hydrogens.
Remember how these things would lose two hydrogens commonly to form an allylic carbocation? The 55 has got to be something where that has occurred and you've got some deal like that going on. So it's all butyl-related stuff around there. Okay, but the big thing for you to look at with alkenes is when you approach one, for example this, let's go back up, take that double bond and figure out what the pieces are, start breaking in the allylic position to it, and subtract out those chunks that are allylic that you break off, and see what you're left behind. Okay? And then vinylic, sort of the last resort. Okay?
So, on an example, if you give us a molecule and a graph, you say what peak corresponds to which part of the
Yeah, I may do that. Is I may give you like that and say, give me a mechanism for the piece at 69. Show me what that is and how it came to be. So I've done that. And I may also give you two different alkenes and a graph and say, tell me which alkene this belongs to. Okay, you can tell that just by breaking off the allylic pieces. One will match, one will. But I'm not going to give you guys a graph like this and say, what molecule is this? I'm not going to do that to you. All right, moving on to benzene. Benzene and its searching for, by the way. In a benzene-type structure, you're going to have, again, sigma and pi bonds. Electrons will come out of the pi bonds most easily, just like before. Even though you destroy aromaticity when you do it, it's still easier to do than grabbing a sigma bond electron. So we're going to be losing pi bond electrons. And what that's going to look like, if you lose that electron, is our chromal group there. Electron comes in, and we, when we lose the electron, we'll get something that looks like this. And I'm going to draw it, dot, plus. You could do it the other way, plus dot, and it would be legitimate. So we won't put, let's just leave the other one, so you don't, I think I actually want the other one for my next one. So I could have gone plus dot. It's okay. Same thing. All right, so this would give us a molecular ion. I guess we'll put bonds in there. And in this case, it's about 120 for the mass on that. And this tends to be fairly prevalent, again, just like alkenes. You tend to see this as a fairly large peak. And I think we have the spectrum there. And, oh, different one. Don't have it. Okay. It would be large if you take a look at it. Now, one of the things that happens, if there's side chain or groups on the benzene, like alkyl-type groups, cleavage will occur at the benzylic position because it gives you benzylic carbocations. So, let's work off of this guy right here. That'll give us the correct picture. And we'll cleave at the benzylic carbon. So, what we are going to do is we will take and cleave right there. So, I'll leave the benzylic carbon there, but I'm going to cleave after that benzylic position. So I'll have one electron go on to the benzylic carbon, and one electron goes away with that ethyl group in this case. So I lose ethyl radical, and I have a CH2 dot, there's a dot, there's a plus. Now that's looking kind of crazy, so we're going to do a little work and straighten it up. First thing we'll do is we'll take those two radicals, couple them together to make a bond. So let's redraw this. There's that, and that, and a plus. This is still not aromatic. And so what I'm now going to do to get the, this tends to be a pretty big peak. So it's showing you that the fragment's stable. As I've drawn it now, not so much. But what we can do is we can take this double bond, flip it down into the ring, and when I do that, we do our redraw number two. Look what I just made. It's a benzylic carbon. So when you cleave at the benzylic position, after enough redrawing, you get a benzylic carbocation. And that is pretty stable. This shows a peak at 91. And it's very typical when you have a benzene ring with one alkyl group coming off, just one alkyl group, very often you'll see a peak at 91. And that's what that is. Okay? Now, it does show on, you guys have on your handout, I think, the tropoleum ion. You guys see that? You see that on your handout at all? Or did I hide it from you? Sounds like I hit it. This is more of a trivia thing. That is the piece I care about because it makes sense. But studies have been done on what that thing actually looks like, and I do not know how they figured this out. I have no clue. But what it actually looks like, going through this piece at 91, the 91 fragment, is actually this.
see if I can draw it right. It does a ring expansion, and it forms the that. It's weird, huh? This is through a ring expansion. And it's called the Tertullian ion. And I have no idea how they figured that out. It has the same mass. Don't know how they figured it out. But what would be the advantage of doing that?
It's aromatic.
The whole thing becomes aromatic, yeah. I've got a cyclic structure. Every carbon's sp2 hybridized. I can delocalize pi electrons, 4n plus 2 pi electrons. The whole thing's an aromatic structure. Yes?
Can you have the whole propyl group fall off?
You can have the whole propyl group fall off, and that is actually the next one. Another thing that can happen is the whole thing comes off. And if that occurs, you're left with a benzene by itself. There's no group attached to it anymore. So if that were to occur, let's take a look at what that picture looks like. There's the propyl. I'm going to draw the parent as being, I'm going to switch now to plus dot. That's going to work for my mechanism. And what I'm going to have happen is the entire propyl group leaves, puts the radical on the benzene now, not the benzoic position, but the benzene. And I have a plus and a dot and a dot. And I'm going to bring the two electrons together and form a bond. What this is something that looks a little bit weird. We haven't seen that one before. Right? A positively charged benzene. And it has a mass of 77. So two masses to often look for. 77 and 91. When you have attached alpha groups on there. Okay, so let's see if we can find it with this one right here. This is it has a butyl group on it. So I would expect to see, looking at that, so that is your parent right there at 134. The other pieces, let's see if we can figure them out. We could cleave right there, and that would be at the benzoic position. And this would give us, so if we lost an ethyl, it would give us this, a benzoic carbocation. That'd be 134 minus 29, which comes out to be, in this higher math, 105. Do you see something at 105? It's a giant something. The peak at 105 is this big peak right here. That's your 105. And so that is from a benzylic cleavage. But that's not the only thing I could have lost. What if I lost instead just the methyl? Let's see if we see that. I don't know if we will or not, but if I lost just the methyl, it would look like this, right? That's minus the methyl. So that would be 134 minus 15 is 119, right? Do you see anything at 119? It's tiny, yeah, it's not very big. Maybe, let's see, 125, the scale is impossible. I think it's this thing right here. I think it's that little tiny thing. So, not so helpful. But it's there, so. Since there is a benzene, if we broke off the whole alkyl group, we would expect to see that. That should be at 77. And there is peak at 77. Yes?
Can you
Yes.
See that there's a big drop on 60.
Oh, a little glitch thing. I don't know what that is. Maybe it's got to be some impurity, because this has to be either 134 or maybe 135, and you count C13 and later. So I don't know what the thing out at one, it's like 161 or so. I don't know what that is. Some impurity or something. Okay? So, when you have pi electrons, take those out first, and then do cleavages to be allylic or benzylic. You can do those kind of carbon cations. All right. Now this is a topic near and dear to my heart. It's molecules with heteroatoms. These are, heteroatoms would be like sulfur, chlorine, bromine, things that are not carbon. And as way of introduction, it has to do with isotopes. And the problem that you run into, that these kind of complicate things just a little bit. Isotopes are atoms that have a different number of neutrons. And, you know, with electrons, we didn't really worry. We knocked out an electron, and we said it didn't affect the mass. We didn't care, because they're so light. Neutrons are heavy. And so when you get different numbers of neutrons, that's going to affect the mass of a compound. So, for an example, let's take a real simple look. If we had CH3Cl, we look at the periodic table and we say, okay, this is 12, that is going to be all three of them is 3, chlorine 35.45. Well, we would add this up and we would say, okay, it's about 35, about 12, about 3, it should be about 50, right? So we'd expect to be 50. Only thing is, there is no B at 50. What I would see is, let me see if we get 50. But I'd see, let's see, 35. Yeah, I'd see a peak at 50, and then I'd see a peak at 52 as well. I would see two of these, a 50 and a 52. Sometimes when you add up the mass off the periodic table, you don't even see that peak. And that is because some atoms, like chlorine, have two isotopes. There is a chlorine 35. Chlorine 37. The mass you see on the periodic table is a weighted average. Remember doing that?
Yeah.
Yeah. There is no chlorine atom that weighs 35.45 atomic mass units or grams. There's no such thing. 35 or 37. So that's just an average reflecting their isotopic abundance. The mass spec does not count average chlorines. It counts the mass of a chlorine atom. And so you will have some molecules coming through that contain chlorine 35 that weigh 50. You'll see a peak of 50. Some of them will come through. They'll have chlorine 37 in them. They're going to weigh 52, too heavier. And so you'll see something at 52. Okay. So when you have atoms that have isotopes, you end up getting several peaks, or molecules with isotopes. So what you have is you get several parent peaks and potentially several fragments if the fragment contains that same atom. Typically what they do is the lowest mass parent, they call M. Then if there is one heavier, if it's heavier by one, they call that M plus one. If it's heavier by 2, they call that M plus 2. So something with a chlorine would have an M, that would be 50. 52 would be M plus 2. It's too heavier. One that is very, very common, it crops up in just about everything, is C13. Most of the carbons shooting through weigh 12. 1% weigh 13. Which is M plus 1. And so on these spectra, and I have a note we can flip back and see if we'll see if it's true. Yeah, it is actually true. On these spectra, here's M, right?
And we looked at this and we said, oh, look, there's M. It's at 134. That little thing right there, M plus 1, that's from the C13 in the molecule, one heavier. And so almost every spectrum is going to have the parent. And if you look real carefully, just one up, a little teeny, 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 M plus 1, and that's C13. Okay? This is near and dear to my heart because when I was taking my oral exam for my doctorate, you have to take this exam in, I guess, your third year or your second, whatever it is. And you sit in a room with five professors for hours, and they grill you on anything that pops into their brains. So it's a painful experience. And I had a mass spec I was showing them of my research. And one of them said, you know, you got a tiny peak there that's higher than your parent. And I'm like, oh, God. And they said, what is that? And I said, I don't know. And you're always told to say you don't know. Don't try to bluff your way out of it because they're smarter than you. So I said, I don't know. And it was C13. And my punishment was I had to go to the library and look up. They gave me a list of like 100 mass specs that I had to look up and analyze. And that was my punishment for not knowing C13. So that little tiny peak is C13. Just in case you wanted to know. Don't forget. Okay, here's a, going up one more, is a table of some of the common atoms that would have some isotopes. Carbon we just talked about. Sulfur is kind of interesting. I can't pop that high, but if you take a look at sulfur right here, the majority are sulfur 32, and they're like 95%. So that's going to be your biggest peak, molecules containing sulfur 32. There's a sulfur 33 that's roughly 1%. So you have a little tiny peak that's M plus 1. And then there's an M plus 2 as well that would actually be bigger. It'd be about 4%. So sulfur has a big parent, a teeny, teeny M plus 1, and a slightly bigger M plus 2. Bromine's really interesting. Look at it. It's 50-50. So if you have bromine in a compound, and you look at your parent area, it looks like this. There's an M, and then there's an M plus 2, and they're exactly the same height, because the ratio of the two is roughly 50-50. So it's kind of interesting to have hetero atoms. There's bromine right there, a real-life spectrum of bromine. And so you can see, once you fragment off that BR, everything's the same. It looks just like normal. But looking at the parent, it's pretty obvious that right there you've got the bromine because of the two equal heights. Chlorine has an M and an M plus 2, and they are in a ratio. Let's go back. If you look at chlorine, it's about 75-25. So one is about, three quarters, and one's about one quarter. And you can see that with chlorine, the lighter one is big, and then the smaller one is about a third that size or so. Okay, yeah.
Is this how they do carbon dating?
No, carbon dating, I think, is a radioactivity issue. Is that right, Chris? Carbon dating is radioactivity?
Most of the time, they can do it with a mass spec.
Can they?
Livermore, they have a huge carbon dating system.
That's based on mass spec,
yeah.
Really? Wow, that's cool. Okay, so there's your answer. Okay, moving on to alcohols. Alcohols have some two really distinctive cleavage patterns. And what we'll do is we'll take a look at, again, a mechanism, and then we'll practice on a real molecule. At least I think we'll be practicing. Catch up on my notes here. Practice on notes. So, with an alcohol, first we got to figure out, and let's just work with one ethanol. Here's an O, here's an H. Or any high energy beam of electrons in scale. So we're going to shoot in electrons. Beam hits. We have to decide what is knocked out first. What I have available is I have sigma electrons and I have N electrons. Those are my lone pair electrons. Which H is more loosely held.
Actually,
remember it goes sigma, pi, n, right? So we are going to knock out a lone pair electron. So once again, we can identify where it comes from. So I'm going to lose an electron. Oxygen loses an electron from the lone pair. And then what happens with an alcohol is you tend to get cleavage on either side of the alcohol carbon. So here's my alcohol carbon right there. I'm going to cleave on either side. And to see why that makes sense, let's go ahead and do one. Take a look. Let's get rid of the CH3 first. So we'll have the CH3 leave as a radical. That puts a radical on the alcohol carbon. So I have a radical there, O, radical there, lone pair, H, plus. There's some redrawing that I can do right now. What I did is I just took and combined those two. Does that look at all kind of familiar? What would be the purpose of doing that? How would that be a good thing to do? Yeah, I can spread this positive charge out now over two atoms. So here's on the oxygen. And then if I were to bring electrons up, I could put it on carbon. So in effect, I've got to localize that positive charge this way. This piece, let's get some masses on this. This guy is 88. This is 88 minus 15. So it is 73. So we're going to look at the spectrum in just a minute. And we should see an 88 and a 73. But I could lose from the other side as well, right? That would be a reasonable thing, too. So I could also leave there, get rid of that. It could be minus a CCC, minus three carbon piece. And I would have C with an H, CH3, and then OH plus. And that's from just the other side. This thing weighs 45. So I should see piece with 45 too. Typically, the largest alkyl group is preferentially lost. So what you see generally, the bigger peak is from the larger R group being cleaved. Not always, but very often that's the preferred method of cleavage. I don't know why it is. Maybe because it makes the radical a little more stable. Okay, so I would expect when we look at it, if that's true, that that should be just a little bit bigger. Okay, don't panic if it's not. It's okay, but usually it is. Another thing that alcohols can do fairly easily is they can dehydrate. And so very often, you see loss of water. So that would be minus 18. Unfortunately, what can happen is that the fragment that this gives you can sometimes immediately fall apart further. And we're going to see an example of that in just a few minutes. So you can get a fragment that may fall apart further. So sometimes the minus 18 is really obvious. Sometimes it's not. And if it's not, water was lost, and then the piece went like that into something else. Okay, so if we have a minus 18, this guy, that would be, what would the mass of that guy be? 70. So we're also going to be looking for something around 70. So this was about 88. So let's take a look with these fragments in mind. There's 2-phenol. First, 88. Do you see anything at 88?
Barely.
Barely, yeah. There's a teeny tiny, teensy weensy little guy right there. You wouldn't probably even notice it if you didn't know you were looking for it, so it's tiny. Yeah. Oh, we'll take a look at one in just a few minutes and hang on to that. There's a peak we're going to have to explain. I don't think we do it in this. We do it in the next example. Okay, how about we said there should be a peak at 73. Do you think it's 73? Right there. It's not huge, but definitely there. So that 73 is where we lost the methyl group. Right there. That was the smaller group, not as popular to lose it, so it's smaller. Then we said, okay, losing the propyl group, that should happen much more. So we should see something at about 45. Look at that. There it is. There's the peak at 45. That's loss of that propyl side, and it's very, very big. And then minus 18, something at 70. Yeah, it's there. It's not tremendously huge. Giant. And so what probably happened is that fragmented into other smaller pieces. Okay, let's do one that's a little more complicated and see if we can't identify some of the pieces.
Well, which is the one at 50?
Which is the one at, this one at 55 right here? Oh, let's see, that is... That's going to be a complicated one. So if you think at 55, let's see if I even noted it down, anything. Let's see if we can quickly figure it out. There's something at 55. So if you took, it's 70 minus 15, I think it's this guy right here. And if you lost a CH3 off of this piece after it dehydrated, that would be 55, right? So that's probably what's going on here. Okay. We're actually going to, on this complicated molecule, we are going to take a look at what happens when you lose the water, and then what happens to that piece that causes the peak for the disappear. So, more complicated, here we go. Let's try to tackle some of the easy pieces first. We know that, let's do loss of water just a minute, because we're going to explore that further. We know it would be reasonable to see that piece of weed dot right there. So this whole thing is 130. Do we see anything at 130?
30, 45,
50. If we do, it's super teeny, so not really. So I don't see much of a parent. There's a very small, and that's being generous, parent. Maybe, kind of. Okay, so that's okay though. So if we cleave off the isopropyl group, we would get, let's just, that would give us this chunk right here, right? So that's going to be 130 minus an isopropyl is 43. And that would give us 130 minus 43, 87?
Yes.
Okay. So this chunk here would be 87. So that's cleavage of the isopropyl. And you can see we've got an 87 here. Okay, so that's good. We explained the piece of 87. Redrawing this. Let's cleave off this piece now. That's a 4-carbon piece. That would leave us with this chunk right here. So this is going to be 130 minus, what's 4 carbons weigh? 8 foots count. 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons is 48, plus 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, and the hydrogens, 57. So what's 130 minus 57? 73. Okay, good. There's the piece of 73. Okay. So, we got 87, we got 73. What do you think all the stuff around 40 is? There's a 43, there's a 41. There's some stuff around 57, kind of clustered in the 57, 55-ish region. What would you guess that is? Yeah, it's going to be that isobutyl in some form or another. Probably what that is. Let's deal with water. We haven't dealt with the water coming off. So, here I think it's probably worth doing a mechanism. And I'm not going to ask you for this mechanism, but it just is going to kind of justify what's going on. This is really, it's pretty complicated. And so it's fun to do if you have a half hour and you can sit and play with it. On a test, it's not fun. So here we go. Loss of water. On a test, what you'll do is you'll just go 130 minus 18, and that will be 112. Do we see something at 112? But it's small. Okay, so we see it, but it's small. So that tells you that whatever we made when we lost water didn't hang around very long, and it fragmented into something else. So let's see if we can figure it out. So here we go. This is something I figured out by just playing and playing and playing with it. So we have our, let's do a hydrogen, these two neighboring hydrogens, O, neighbor. So this is the parent. And now, let's see if we can figure out what's happening. What we're going to do is we are going to have the oxygen radical come over and attack the hydrogen. The neighboring hydrogen seems to work out. The hydrogen, this bond carbon to hydrogen, is going to break. The hydrogen gets one electron. The carbon that it is attached to gets the other. So we now have that branch. I have O, H, H, a radical there, and I still have a plus on my oxygen, and it still has O. Okay, so what I basically did is formed an OH bond. Okay, then next, water leaves. And it's going to leave with both electrons in the bond. So we are going to have so something happened to it. Okay. Ready? So it fell apart to give something a little bit better. Yes. So, what we're going to do now is we are going to cleave off this isopropyl group. And when I do that, I'm going to put another electron on the carbon that's still around. There's a reason you're not going to do this on the test. So we have isopropyl radical, and we have this. And
this is a CH right here. We'll redraw this from the bond. Plus right there, this thing has a mass of 69. So this would be the fragment that was 112 minus, what is it, 43 that we just kicked out of there? Ends up with a piece that is 69. What do you see?
It's the biggest one.
Yeah. So water was lost, definitely. That was a really big deal, having water lost. But the thing we got then immediately fragmented to give us another peak that was huge, because there's a lot of it, but it just isn't just simply loss of water. So what happens is typically water's lost, and then you lose like a methyl, like we noticed in the last one, or in this case, an isopropyl or something else.
Yes. Is it so big because the molecule is symmetrical?
No, I don't think so, because it would be, the OH had to come from there, so I don't know if you would plus, maybe, it might be because it's so symmetrical, but I think also, yeah, maybe that's the answer to it, because you could reverse these two and draw the same thing from this, so that would double your chances. Okay, I won't ask you this mechanism. Yes?
Could the oxygen also grab this device?
This one down here?
No,
on this side,
yeah.
I suppose you could, and do the same thing.
Yeah,
I don't know what kind of piece that would give you, though.
That would be minor piece, small piece.
I don't know. I mean, what you typically would have to do is say you saw a big peak, and this didn't explain it, and start working on the other side. Okay, so that's sort of your trivia thing. You won't see them.
It's not curiosity, the water, maybe.
No, because it is, has a positive charge right here, so when it takes those electrons, it's just leaving as H2O. Because it's positively charged here, and then it just becomes neutral. Yeah?
In that step right there, could
this crazy one right here?
Yeah. Could a methyl cleave off to form an allylic carbocation?
If that happened, let's see what that would do. If this methyl cleaved, lost that right there, then we would have a plus, a dot, which would then give us that, right? So what would that be? That'd be 112 minus 15, which is what, 97? Anything there at 97? 80, 90, 100. There is something there at 97. Do you see it there?
Mm-hmm.
But it's small. So that would be an explanation for what's sitting there. If this cleavage occurred to give an allylic carbocation, it'd be at 97, and there is something sitting there. But it's super teeny. But it could be.
Why is that less?
I don't know. I don't have an answer for why this would happen less than that. I don't know. A lot of times what you do with mass spec, you don't try to analyze every peak. So like I would not normally look at the 97 and try to figure out what that is, because it's so small, peaks don't care. But what you a lot of times try to do is to look at your major peaks and figure out plausible fragments for what they could be, and make sure that you can actually get, based on your structure, a reasonable piece that has that mass. You try to make it fit.
What is really the main focus of actually doing mass spec?
Molecular ion peak. That's what I always looked at. I always zoomed down to see if I could see it, and then I looked at major fragments. Made sure I could analyze the major peaks. The rest of them, I didn't worry about. Okay, amines. I liked amines. Their fragmentation pattern is kind of fun. They tend to fragment very easily. So the molecular ion is typically small, sometimes not even there. And what they will do is, first let's talk about the molecular ion. There's something called the nitrogen rule. If you're not sure you have a nitrogen in your molecule, one of the things that you can do is look at the magnitude of the molecular ion. Every molecular ion we've looked at, you may not have noticed this, has been an even number, right? Every single one of them. And that's because carbon has four things on it. And so it's going to have an number. But nitrogen, because it is trivalent, has, let's see what alkyl is on there, has only three things on it, right? And then a lone pair. And a lone pair doesn't weigh anything to speak of. And so when you have a molecular ion with a nitrogen in the compound, it has an odd mass. So that if you see a molecular ion with an odd mass, that's yelling at you that you have something that you've either misidentified your molecular ion or there's a nitrogen in it because of its trivalent. Now, as far as the fragmentation goes, on an amine, what tends to fragment? So you have a bunch of carbons out here. When you're trying to figure out what is fragmenting, you are going to cleave the bond that is adjacent to the nitrogen. So we're going to have a molecular ion that we'll draw, and then they typically cleave right there. And if there are three groups attached to it, we'll cleave three different places and get three different peaks and see if we can find them. So as far as why that is occurring, let's take a look. You will have, and let's just do this guy right here, H there. This one's going to be pretty boring. You'll hit this with an electron, iron giving electrons. Once again, the easiest thing to remove is the lone pair. So you'll remove a lone pair electron, and you will have this guy right here, eight plus. And so what we're going to do is we're going to start cleaving at the what's called the alpha position. So we're going to start cleaving things off right there. So the first thing let's do is let's kick out the ethyl group. Managed cleaving right there?
Bond.
I can drop a double bond. Exactly. So this is really NH plus double bond to a CH2. And that has a mass of 72, to be minus the CC. If I broke on this side, it's the same thing because it's symmetric. So kind of boring example that way. Another type of cleavage that you can see, we didn't break off, it's a group, so to speak. Sometimes you see just the loss of a hydrogen. You'll see your M, and then you see an M minus 1. And what's going on there? There's cleaving off a hydrogen instead of an alkyl group. So what that would look like, let's say I had a hydrogen right there. If I break right there like that, it's going to look like this. With a plus, and it has an H on the still. And then I will have the carbons are all still there, the double bond there. So I just lost one hydrogen, and that will be an M minus 1. And those are kind of the main cleavages you see involving the nitrogen. And then I would see pieces for propyl, pieces for whatever the alkyl groups are. So let's practice on something a little more exciting. Let's do that. Okay. Redrawing this guy. Go through the mechanism on it, let's look at the pieces. We could cleave right there. That's one. And the thing weighs 129. So cleaving right here would be 129 minus 43. What's that going to be?
86.
So that would give us a piece, it's 86. And there it is. It's sitting right here.
75, 80, 85, there's your 86 right there. It's pretty big. So there's your 86. Let's take a look at some of the other choices. I could cleave, ooh, I have two places over here. I could cleave off, going to the position next to the nitrogen, cleave off the level. That would accomplish it too. That would be 129 minus 15, which is going to be 97. No. 129. Do we see a parent? That would be 129. There is one. And we're going to count the little lines now. There's 125, 26, 27, 28, 29. So there's definitely a 129. We see this. And we see a 128. What's that 128? It's minus the hydrogen on the alpha carbon. So you lost the hydrogen somewhere off of it. So all the major peaks are there. Now here's something for you though. We did not do a thing down in here. Right? We didn't play down here at all. See if you can tell me what they are. Stuff around 55, 57. What is that? It's that butyl stuff, okay? That's that alkyl group. How about the things around 43? That's the isopropyl stuff coming off. How about the stuff around 29 or so? That's loss of ethyl.
Okay.
Those aren't so interesting because they're alkyl chunks. They can be helpful, but loss of an ethyl, I mean, who doesn't have that, right? So that's kind of like having an sp3ch in brain. Okay, Nisha. No, I won't do that to you. I won't give you like a formula and then just a mass spec and say what is it. I may give you a formula, a hydrogen and a proton and a mar and a mass spec. I might do that. But just a mass spec by itself I won't do. Just do it. Yeah, it's hard. All right.
I have a curiosity. When they're running this stuff, they usually use like NMR and mass spec.
Oh, absolutely. When this is being used for analysis, you usually report an IR. You report an NMR, proton NMR, a C13, and a mass spec. All four things together. Okay, ethers we're just going to kind of zip through because they're very, very much like amines. It's kind of a repeat. With an ether, you end up having, let's just do this guy, having your electron removed from the oxygen, so that ends up being your parent. It's very, very amine-like. And so as a result, the cleavage patterns are the same. And so it's going to cleave like an amine. And so what you're going to do is you're going to have cleavage at the alpha position. So the same kinds of things will occur. So the mass of this guy is 116. Do you see a 116? Yeah, it's there, it's tiny, but it's way down kind of near 120. It's pretty small. On this one, I think I don't have, I'm missing a carbon. There. So what we'll do is we will look at cleavage
and then we'll look at cleavage that side and see what happens. So if we cleave on the butyl side, we are losing this chunk right here. So we have 116 minus the 3 carbon piece. That's 116 minus 43. That should give you something that is 73. And looking at this, there it is, right there. So there's your 73, right there. So it worked. If we cleave on the other side, again, leave the alpha carbon in place, cleave beyond it. We have 116 minus 29, so we're losing an ethyl group. And 116 minus 29 is 87. There's a little peak at 87 as well. Then the biggest peaks of this thing are like 57, 43, 29. It's actually the alpha groups coming off that are giving the biggest peaks. And those are, you know, they're important because it does prove if you've got something at 57, it's a real good indicator that there was a 4 carbon piece, which is totally reasonable for that molecule. Yes?
If you had a propyl group on either side, you couldn't differentiate between the two?
You could not, that's correct. Yeah, this only does masses, and so it's not so good in terms of if you can lose a 3 carbon piece from either side, you can't tell which one can. Okay, now this next one is probably the biggest class of compounds, just sort of an overall umbrella, and that's carbonyl compounds. So what we're going to talk about applies to ketones, aldehydes, esters, carboxylic acids, all those things, anything with carbonyl. The best place for you to look at for like practice mass specs when you're studying them or you want to learn more about them, the mass spec chapter is a little bit weird. It's kind of very general. If you've read through it, you've seen that. The actual functional groups, don't look into if you want to know about amines in your mass spec, go look in the amines chapter and read in there. Because they always talk about the IR of amines, the NMR of amines, the mass spec of amines. So it's also embedded within the chapters for the functional groups. So to practice carbonyls, go to the ketones and aldehydes, and go to carboxylic acids and things like that. Now, as far as how they cleave, there are 4 types of cleavages or fragments that we can see. Sometimes you see them all, sometimes you don't. So let's go ahead and run through them, and then we'll do a practice module. All right. First example, we'll work on a ketone to show it. So cleavage type number 1. This is going to be on either side of the C double bond O. So we will be cleaving right there at the carbonyl. So let's do with our example and see why that happens. As is the usual, we're going to knock out an electron. We can take it from sigma. We can take it from pi, because I have a C double bond O, or lone pair, and that's what we're going to take it as lone pair. So we have that guy right there. Now, with the cleavage, what we're going to do is we're going to break it right there at the carbonyl. So one electron goes with the ethyl, one electron goes on to the carbonyl part. So we're going to lose an ethyl. Visually helpful to do this. How do you like that?
I don't know.
Okay, obviously it should be linear for me, but I don't really do things that it wants to do. So, what do you think about that? It's kind of ugly, huh? You've seen it before.
Yeah.
It didn't bother you when you saw it before. It's kind of yucky looking. Where did you see that?
It was in rain.
It was like, that was benzyne. We saw a weird triple bond there, but you have seen actually with an oxygen. You've seen this. Huh? It was with Friedel crafts. Remember with Friedel
we used the Lewis acid catalyst, and it pulled chlorine off, remember that? And put the plus right there, and then the benzene went and attacked it. And we all looked at that one, and then we talked about how it's actually okay because it can be stabilized through resonance, remember that? And it formed this. Right? This is the acylium ion. And we saw it in Friedel graphs. So the thing does actually exist. It's not completely crazy that it would form that. So you have actually seen it before. So by cleaving at the carbonyl, you get an acylium ion. Just like what we saw in Friedel graphs. Okay? The next example is doing the same thing with an ester. Let's take a look at that. Same process. With the ester, OCH3, we'll draw our parent. And then what we'll do is, let's go ahead and let's cleave off the OCH3 part. So we'll have an electron there, and that's going to give us the OCH3 radical frequency. Gives us that.
If that one of those electrons that's moved up onto the oxygen, would it be more stable than part of that?
Well, maybe. It's just a resonance structure. So it could. You can draw the actual molecules hybrid of those two. Okay? So when you're confronted with a ketone, an aldehyde, an ester, an amide, start breaking off at the carbonyl. And with the ester, it wouldn't be unreasonable. You may see a fragment for the OCH3 coming off. You may be able to find it in your mass spec. And then, go test the other side too, okay? Test it, get another fragment for that guy coming off as well. And you'll probably see that too. So do both sides. Okay, this next one is cleavage at the carbonyl to give an alkyl cation. That one's not so exciting, sort of the opposite of what we just did. So number two, that's sort of standard mass spec stuff. You're going to see peaks for, and this thing is going to look like you just give you the structure of the other piece. It looks like that. This piece is a radical. Away from any place that can be stabilized completely, right? It seems terrible. less dry. What we would end up with is this. Bunch of sage. And I am going to put a plus charge right there. It seems just terrible. Okay? So I ended up losing a radical, which was three carbon piece. That looks like it totally would not be stable. But draw the enol form. The enol form looks like this. What do you see? It's allylic, right? So what it is, leaving there, which looks completely insane, is actually stabilized by the enol form of the carbonyl. And the last one, and this is the fun one. It's a good way to end. This one has a name. It's so fun. It's called the McLafferty Rearrangement. And this will only happen if you have your side chain has one, two, three, at least three carbons. It has to have three plus carbons. Well, three plus carbons. They're annoying. Okay. What happens with the McLafferty? Let's do it with this ketone. I'm going to draw some arrows for you guys. So we've got this, like that. This, like this. And then there's hydrogen. We're going to draw that hydrogen in. And we're going to draw in plus. Okay. I need my lone pair on top. Put the lone pair on top, radical on the side. Are you ready for the McLafferty? I got a sheet here, so I make sure I get it right. It's all one big thing. So you get your parent. Then it cleaves like this. You grab the hydrogen. Electrons come down, form an alkene. That causes this bond to break. Right here, we're going to break this bond. Those electrons come over into the carbonyl. Both of them. These are all double arrows. And that pushes electrons on with the oxygen. So what this ends up being is this. I formed a double bond into my carbonyl, which this is now an OH. And then I have a double bond. So you end up forming an alkene plus this thing that looks, it's an enol, essentially. And the net result of a McLafferty is I broke right here. My cleavage occurred right there between the alpha and beta carbons. That's a really interesting one. So what we'll do is, we don't have time to go through all those. There's a practice one, and what I'll do is I'll put up on D2L the different cleavages and what their masses are, so you guys can go with that.